focus on the ideas of health and health and well-being, social well-being, but also financial security. And when you start tying all those things together, you realize that the good news is now that, you know, in Canada, if you were born in 1900, your life expectancy was 51 years of age. When we created our pension systems here, our life expectancy was about 62 years of age. And now, you know, a typical Canadian can expect to live to about 82 years on age, older if you're a woman, younger if you're a man. So we have one of the longest life expectancies in the world, but we have a significant number of people who are retiring without the financial security they need. And the reality for some Canadians that you might outlive your savings, that really can create economic insecurity and concerns about, well, if I don't have any money to live, you know, what's the point, for example. So how do we reduce financial insecurity? That's some of the work that we focus on. But also thinking about the issues of not only is, you know, preserving health and promoting health important, but social well-being is so important too. So we do a lot of focus on measuring rates of social isolation, loneliness, and actually looking at what are solutions we can do. So we published a major report last year with support from the Retired Teachers of Ontario. And we focused on countries like what Japan is doing, what Australia is doing, what New Zealand is doing, and even Britain, for example, where they have actually appointed a minister responsible for loneliness. Some of you may have seen a few weeks ago, the U.S. Surgeon General talked about social isolation and loneliness being an epidemic in the United States as well. And it's a huge issue here as well. But the key point is that, you know, there are things we can do to combat social isolation and loneliness. And the value of doing that is that we know that loneliness itself is thought about as the equivalent to smoking up to 15 cigarettes a day. But if you can actually improve social connections, you can support health and well-being and allow people to have a more dignified later life. So there are things we can do, there are concrete things we can do, but I think, as you said, if we have people who are financially insecure, if we have people who are socially isolated, lonely, then I agree, you know, it's not pretty, you know, and aging is not easy. But these are things that if we put our minds to it, we can tackle each of these things so that we can allow everybody to have, you know, long but healthy and active and independent life.
Thank you, Dr. Sen. I was wanted to just see if there's anyone in the audience that might have a question, and I'll turn the mic over to this gentleman right here.
Thank you, James. Doctor, I'm 84 years old. I guess I'm 1 year beyond the life expectancy. May I ask you if you approve of the way Canada has approached the debate issue? Are we going the right way?
You know, I actually have to say that, right now I approve, you know, kind of how we've been looking at this. It's been a very measured approach, right? And it's been, I think, a very thoughtful approach. I think given how controversial this issue can be, you know, I really do strongly believe that, you know, that everybody should have the right to determine kind of how they want to live their lives. What I struggled with was when people are choosing to end their life early because they are financially insecure, or they're lonely or isolated. They can't get good health care, or they can't access palliative care services so that they want to, and they don't want to suffer because we create unnecessary suffering. So that's where I put in a charter challenge. I'm a lead. I put in a challenge saying that we are discriminating, particularly against older Canadians, by not making palliative care services, for example, more accessible, right? Because palliative care is not about, you know, promoting death, it's about promoting quality of life. But for so many Canadians, they can't access that. So I have patients who say, I don't want to suffer, and if I can't get them the services, can I blame them? And I don't think we should be coercing people in decisions on that basis. That being said, you know, I had the privilege of being appointed by the Ministers of Justice and Health a few years ago with a number of other colleagues to really look at these thorny issues of advance requests, looking at these issues of mature minors and that, and where people say, well, why are they delaying? Like, what's going on there? These are really complex areas, and they're not simply black or white. And so I really do appreciate kind of the thoughtful conversations that are happening, the safeguards that we continue to think about and put in place. And even when Quebec announced their move forward on advance requests, I actually have to say I was quite impressed with the nuance and the approach they've taken to, again, safeguard the well-being of older individuals as well. So I do think we're having a measured conversation. And I think that's a sign of a progressive society that wants to respect people's rights, but also needs to also recognize that we shouldn't be coercing people into decisions based on a lack of services that they have the right to receive as well.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Betty Wood Lawrence. I'm a nurse myself. I know there's a group of seniors who cannot afford to go to nursing home, and they don't have any family members. They are called vulnerable adults. I know there has been a program. There are 30 nurses in Toronto assigned to visit these people at home to assess their situation. Some of these seniors would have bed bugs, lice, infested places. During COVID, they couldn't even go and get their vaccine. During the middle of COVID, I'm talking about 2021 and 2022, this program has been canceled. So that, I don't know if you're aware of it, but I will follow up. I'm so happy to see the Japanese Cultural Center and the HLS and the NIA together, a voice to speak for these people. And personally, I really appreciate you on CBC. You are asking people to consider prevention of pneumonia with Prevnar 20. Unfortunately, that's not covered by OHIP. So please don't stop doing that, because the new virus or even flu, whatever, weaken our lung to when you suffer from pneumonia, that's getting very serious. Thank you very much.
Sure, thank you very much, Betty. And I think, again, you raised the fact that right now we have a number of gaps kind of in the healthcare services and supports that we need to be providing. And that really bothers me. I'm in geriatrician, right? So my day-to-day job is I care for older people. I do home visits. I see people in my office. I see people in the hospital. And certainly the pandemic really showed how vulnerable our healthcare system is. And how vulnerable certain people can become very quickly when they can't no longer access the home care services or the other things. We, you know, as a country, as a very wealthy country, we underspend compared to our other OECD countries, other international comparison countries on the provision of long-term care services. And when you don't give people home and community care options that actually are cheaper for all of us as taxpayers and governments to deliver, people get prematurely institutionalized in long-term care homes. We need to actually be funding more long-term care services overall. We need to be giving people better options so that they're not necessarily living in some of the conditions that you described. And we need to be having a much more better connected system. So I will continue advocating for this. We all need to continue advocating for this, because it bothers me when I hear about massive surpluses and unspent dollars, and then I hear about stories like this as well. We have the money, and frankly, it's not about just spend, but smart investments in the right forms of care actually save us more expensive forms of care when you're just dealing constantly with consequences and crises, as opposed to being proactive and preventive as well.
Oh, by the way, I'm 74 years old. There you go.
Strategies that the government adopts in taking care of the older population. Over here, I get the feeling that we're focusing more and more on building government infrastructure and funding, etc., for the aging population. I was thinking about it from the lens of the community and borrowing from some cultures that actually value things like family values or close by relatives coming to the aid of people towards the later parts of their lives. So for example, in the movie, I, as somebody who comes from the South Asian community, was shocked to see that there was no son or daughter or granddaughter or relative that would come to the aid of these people. So why, instead of focusing on infrastructure, why aren't we focusing on building that community and marketing those kind of family values wherein kids and close by relatives step up and provide that sense of community and support for people, if that makes sense?
No, it makes sense, but I think you raise a number of issues here. So you know, first of all, I agree. I think well, let's do some audience participation. How many people here aspire to end up in a long-term care home? Please raise your hand. I think the mic is broken, James. Now, how many of you aspire to age as long as possible in your own homes? Right? So it's the majority of what we want. And when you look at any culture around the world, you know, everybody says the same thing. This is what we want. So, you know, I do find myself at odds currently with the government here that is hell-bent on building infrastructure and not putting anywhere close to equal investments in growing our home and community care services and other supports that would support more people to age in place at a much less expensive cost. So that's a challenge, right? But that's ideology, right? You know, people think that voters like to see ribbon cuttings in front of big buildings because you see a solution there. I've tried to pitch to this government, you know, do a ribbon cutting in front of an older person's home, celebrating that, you know, we're helping so-and-so. You know, look, we're doing a ribbon cutting in front of Betty's home. We've kept Betty, you know, here, you know, in her home longer, right? You can have thousands of ribbon cuttings every day if we wanted to do that. Anyway, so they're considering that. I think the interesting thing, too, is one thing that I've learned, you know, being of South Asian heritage as well. And, you know, people say, well, like I have patients who say, you're South Asian, you know, we don't put our family members in homes. We don't do that. They do, right? But then we can be very damaging with our assumptions, right? Because I sometimes have conversations with people from our cultures, if you will, where I say, we're not living in the old country. We're not living in an intergenerational household. We're not living in an intergenerational community. Sometimes a success in a country as big as Canada is that your children, you know, who love you very much, like in my case, I love my parents very much, but, you know, they're two sons. My parents live in Winnipeg, and they got one son in Toronto. They have the other one in Baltimore, right? But my parents, you know, that first of all, they should have had sons, I would say, right? They should have had daughters. But number two, they actually think they're okay because they had a geriatrician, right? So I get nervous every fall when, you know, winter comes around, thinking about snow shoveling and those sorts of things. But I think we have the danger of putting kind of cultural notions on certain folks, because sometimes we end up doing less for certain communities. And we've seen this in Britain and other multicultural communities where we say they look after their own, so they don't need services, or they don't come and access services because they don't need us, where actually we don't create language appropriate or culturally safe and appropriate care. So I think we have to be very careful about some of the myths and the realities. But what we have established here is that most people want to stay in their own homes for as long as possible. There are things we can do to strengthen investments in home and community care. We have to recognize that in Ontario alone, we have 4 million unpaid caregivers who are mostly family members, some providing 24/7 support to their loved one living with dementia. And if we don't see those people and help families and friends, you know, be able to better support their loved ones and build that community and create that community, then we're doing a disservice. So we know what we need to do. But we should be very careful not to be tied down with assumptions that might actually make us sometimes approach things in an inappropriate way as well. So I think I just want to bring a little bit of that perspective too, in terms of how I've learned a lot more cultural humility and not making assumptions about cultures or about family structures as well.